My name is Juliana Valencia. I am a social services specialist with Fairfax Area Agency on Aging. Before we dive into today's topic, I would like to start this conversation by acknowledging that faith and spirituality are complex and profound topics. And although an hour is really not going to be enough, we hope that through this conversation, we can explore how faith and spirituality can help family caregivers in their journey while promoting awareness of their own spiritual traditions and worldviews when caring for someone they love. Now, a few housekeeping items before we begin today's session. Today's presentation is being recorded. A link to the recording is going to be sent to all of you next week. Also, if you have any questions during today's presentation, please use our Q&A button. We are going to have a session for Q&A with all of you. At the same time, I would like if you could fill out our survey at the end of today's presentation. If you could take a moment to do that, it really helps us provide topics that you are interested in. Now, I would like to introduce our panelists for today. So we have four faith leaders with us. We have Father Juan Puigbo, who is a Catholic priest at St. Leo, the Great Catholic Church in Fairfax. Then we have Reverend Ronald Covata, who is a minister emeritus from the Buddhist Churches of America. We have Reverend Dr. Kenneth Patrick from the Parish Minister Marvin Chapel United Methodist Church, and who also serves as a chaplain at Blue Ridge Hospice. And we have Rabbi Joshua Ackerman, who serves as a chaplain at the Jewish Social Services Agency. Now, thank you to all of you for being here with us. And I would like to start this conversation with the following quote from Dr. Christina Bukowski. Spirituality is the aspect of humanity that refers to the way individuals seek and express meaning and purpose, and the way they experience their connectedness to the moment, to self, to others, to nature, and to the significant or sacred. Now, with that in mind, let's begin the conversation by understanding the concepts of spirituality and religion. Each one of the panelists represents a different religion. And from that point, I would like all of you to tell us from your point of view, what is the difference between spirituality and religion? And if we could start with Father Juan Puigbo.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's good to be together. Thank you, Juliana, for doing this. And yes, so it's important to know that we are spiritual beings. And we're also structured beings. With that in mind, being spiritual means that we are referred to a transcendental, to God. That is why sometimes we feel these kind of voids that can be only fulfilled by that orientation, natural orientation that we have to God. And we are a structured being, and that is why spirituality needs a form. And that is why we need religion. So religion help us guide our spirituality. And of course, the way we relate to the sacred, to God. And of course, different cultures have different ways to express their spirituality, their way, how they relate to the divine, to the sacred, to God.
Thank you so much, Father Puigbo. If we could move on to Reverend Covata.
Okay, good morning from Portland, Oregon. And it's a pleasure to join the panelists in this reflection on spirituality and caregiving. And so But I always begin with a disclaimer. I'm not here to represent Buddhists. I represent whoever agrees with me. And that's the extent of what I'm confident with. But anyway, so the question about spirituality and religion, you know, I see spirituality as the formless, the spiritual, and the sense of being. So, you know, I like to kind of use this term SOB story instead of a sermon. So when I give talks, I'm giving SOB stories, standing for sense of being. The stories that give us a sense of being alive. And that's what, to me, spirituality is. However, religion, I see as the form. The form, you know, the different expressions of spirituality in all the different idioms and ways that cultures have come to express that we kind of have to acknowledge at some point is inexpressible. But still, to connect that is the role of religion, the form and the formless. And so that's my reflection on that question about spirituality and religion.
Thank you so much.
I hope it makes sense.
Yes. Thank you so much, Reverend Kubata. If we can now have Reverend Patrick.
Sure. Thank you. It's been great to be with you this afternoon. Coming at this as a hospice chaplain, working with people of so many faiths and so many values and so many different ideals, I see spirituality as like a broad umbrella. It's an experience of the human heart and soul. And I think we're all spiritual beings on the earth having this physical experience. So everyone has a spirituality. We all connect up with something that gives our lives meaning, purpose, and value. And I think religion's the expression of a spirituality in a particular culture, a particular way we express that in society and spiritual beliefs and values. And I see in hospice care, some people, religion is very powerful in expressing their spirituality. Some people reject religion because I think religion has created so many wars and conflicts on our planet. People see so many religious leaders corrupt and immoral. I just wanted to mention as a hospice chaplain, I teach the spiritual care of dying people at the end of life. And it's always been fascinating to me in doing this work for about 15 years that we leave little mementos or signs of our spirituality all around us in the place where we live. So it could be pictures of people, it could be plaques, awards, certificates, plants or animals. And I think it'd be really interesting for someone, say as a hospice chaplain, to go into your living space, your bedroom or your living room, your family room, and observe what you have around you as the signs of your spirituality, of what you bond with. In spiritual being in your life. So as a spiritual guide, I would ask the question, what are the tokens you have around you in your living space that reflect the spirituality in your heart and your soul? Thank you.
Thank you. That's actually a good something to think about. I've never thought about that. Thank you.
Sure.
Now let's move on to Rabbi Ackerman.
Yeah, it's certainly a pleasure and honor to participate in this panel, and hard following after all of your thoughts. I don't think I can do it any better, but maybe just something a little bit different or add a little something here. And while I work in hospice, I'm going to talk a bit more about Judaism in my response here. And from a Jewish perspective, it's really important to consider the tremendous weight of observance as a dominant mode of religious life. When we think about the Torah, that's the Jewish scripture, and all the rabbinic concerns and conversations over two millennia, there is this incredible focus on the law. And according to the rabbis, there's 613 commandments, 245 positive, 365 negative, and there's so much energy expended by them in their attempt to understand these commandments. I want to look at one of them. In Exodus 20:18 has the verse, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall do labor and do all your work, but on the seventh is the Sabbath of the Lord. And the rabbi says, how? How do we do that? And as they look into this in their conversations, they develop 39 categories of work, 39 major categories of work. And Rabbi Judah the Patriarch, he is the editor of the Mishnah in the first century. He says, even then, their efforts here were like they suspended a mountain from a hair, from thread. And I think that this statement is one that comes from a spiritual perspective, that he's describing that rabbi's activities here as a desire to understand and live according to God's will. as it's expressed in the Torah. And for the rabbis, the spiritual fulfillment is to live inside of these commandments. That kind of flies in the face of typical understanding of where religion is about a structure and being bound. But for them, it was something that they could be enmeshed in and encounter the divine. Just very briefly, sorry, I'm going a little long on this, but that's not for everybody. That's not for everyone who's Jewish, and that's not for everybody globally. And lots of Jewish people enter into religion from a very different perspective. And that has ancient roots as well. And that looks towards understanding our actions of immense consequence, both within the human realm and natural realm, and also as we're able to interact with the divine. And I just want to bring one kind of image a person welcoming the Sabbath, traditionally standing before our candlesticks and lighting the candles and closing their eyes. And that is a moment of spirituality, gathering together with family and friends, sometimes by yourself. And you look into the flames, and you understand this light is a blessing of joy and comfort. And this is an intensely spiritual moment for most people, and allows them to recognize the feelings and the hopes, their concerns that are inside of them, to give them attention and to bring them forward. And so that is, you know, that is the type of spirituality in Judaism that looks for those moments for the individual and self-expression.
Thank you. It sounds something similar to what Reverend Patrick was saying, the connection with things that are not just important to you, but also are very meaningful from a religious perspective. So my next question for all of you, it says the human existence, it's shaped my many life experiences, ranging from joy to suffering, from happiness to distress, and so on and so forth. So when a loved one is diagnosed with a chronic illness or has an accident or has been diagnosed with a terminal illness, some of us might wonder, why me or why my loved one? From a spiritual perspective, what would you want those families and loved ones who are going through tough times to know? If we could start with Father Puigbo.
Yes. From the Christian perspective, we see the teachings of Jesus telling us that God is our Father, that we should trust Him, that He leads us, and whatever happens is good for us, even though we don't understand, like a father or a mother, sometimes shaping the life of their children, and it sometimes doesn't make sense to them, but it's for their good, and God, in His infinite love, wants our good. So we see also Jesus promising us eternity, paradise, that we will be in heaven with Him for all eternity after this life. So this life is not the end. So sometimes when we are at the end of life, or we see somebody that we love suffering, we can also see that as an opportunity to be united to God as we also see our weaknesses. This is where the great virtue of hope comes into place. So we trust. I always tell people to repeat 3 times, trust, I trust, I trust, to be completely surrendered into the hands of the Father that wants our best. And of course, we believe in the resurrection. But before resurrection, if we know the life of Jesus before resurrection is the cross, is the crucifixion. So we are also called to embrace our own crosses, whatever is difficult and painful, and in hope that one day we are going to be not only in heaven, but also to be risen from the dead. So that's the ultimate goal of Christian life.
Mm-hmm. To surrender and accept. Right. I like that. It's kind of hard. It's very hard at that moment, right?
Well, yesterday, this man was dying, and I was with him when he was dying. And we both prayed. I mean, you know that the last sense to lose is the healing, right? So I could notice that he knew what I was doing, and it was so beautiful to see how he let go. You know, he understood that it was the time to completely entrust his life to God. And today, his son, who is not a believer, came and said, "Wow, that was a powerful moment. I don't know what happened there." Well, I know it was God who was there. So we all can sense that, even though we don't have to believe at that moment in the same religion, but it's God taking care of our lives.
Thank you so much, Father Puico. I'll remember that, to trust and surrender. Thank you. Reverend Cabada, if we can move on to you.
Okay. I guess in a word, you know, the idea, as I appreciate the religion we call Buddhism, is the idea of awakening, or they sometimes say a light enlightenment. So it's a process of transforming ignorance into enlightenment, suffering to joy, or I would add complaints to gratitude. So that's the journey we're on. As a result of being born into human life, we encounter the human condition. And what is the, you know, when we're talking about being on a journey, that suggests there's a goal. So what's the goal of this journey? And by the way, I give you a heads up, you know, I like to play with acronyms. So the acronym I'll introduce here is GOAL, G-O-A-L. And so that's gratitude, openness, acceptance, and liberation or love. And that's the goal of the spiritual journey, to awaken to that sense of being alive with the gratitude, the openness, acceptance, and love or liberation. So the idea, the image is that we're caught in this cycle of what we call birth and death. You know, the aimless, you know, like the treadmill, just running on and on, never ending up anywhere. So the idea is to break out of that cycle of aimless delusion. And that's the liberation we call Buddhahood, awakening to, essentially, I would call it our oneness. Awakening to the fact that I don't exist alone. To realize the sense of oneness with immeasurable life is another way I would describe it. The oneness with immeasurable life. So the metaphor is like, you know, we're like waves that appear on the surface of an ocean, and we move along but eventually disappear from the surface. But we awaken to the fact that we're not that individual, you know, fickle wave, but we're the essence of the ocean. That's the immeasurable life. In our tradition, we refer to as Amida Buddha. Amida is a Sanskrit word which translates as immeasurable light and life, which represents wisdom and compassion. So that's the ocean of immeasurable life that we're all a part of. And so the idea is to awaken to that essence, to that sense of oneness with all beings. And I'll just throw in this joke anyway. Why did the Buddhist medical examiner get fired? Why did the Buddhist medical examiner get fired? The punchline is because he or she kept writing on the death certificate, the cause of death, birth. Mm-hmm. That's the reality of our existence. The moment we were born, we were beginning this process of dying that culminates in this experience we call death. But that's on the surface of life. But to appreciate the so-called essence of our being that never dies is the oneness that I think sustains us and embraces us just as we are. So that's the reflection I offer for this occasion. Maybe I'll change my mind later, but anyway, for this moment, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. I like that acceptance and to awake. How does one awake to it?
Awake? Mm-hmm. Well, we in our tradition, we talk about listening to the teachings of the Buddha, the Dharma, hearing the call of immeasurable life that's encouraging us to wake up, to see the reality of our mortality, but to appreciate the fact that we don't. So I always describe it as recognizing we don't exist forever, but more essentially appreciating that we don't exist alone. We are always together in immeasurable life.
We have a common shared humanity, right?
Humanity, well, not just humans, but with all beings.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Reverend Kubata. If we can move on to Reverend Patrick.
As a hospice chaplain, the thing I'd want to communicate to the terminally ill patient or family is that it's okay to trust life. It's okay to trust the divine presence, and life is trustworthy no matter how it unfolds. I had the experience several years ago of Guillain-Barré, and I was paralyzed in neurological intensive care. I couldn't move a muscle. I couldn't take care of myself. I was inside of a nightmare I couldn't wake up from. My body was frozen like a block of wood, but I was fully alert, oriented times three. And what brought me peace was saying yes to this experience and accepting it as the unfolding of the present moment. So I may not personally like how this moment's unfolding. I may not want it. I may desire it, but I can't accept it. So I think it's okay to fully trust the present moment. That's what came to me. And it's okay to trust the divine source of life, however we experience it. And I would want to have the patient or family see that the terminal illness is their teacher that has come into their life and has taught them how to accept this present moment and receive each moment as a gift from God. We all want to decide ahead of time how our life's supposed to unfold. Then we get angry and upset and suffer when it doesn't unfold the way we want. But maybe the terminal illness is teaching you how to accept this moment. It maybe is the most powerful teacher you'll ever have in your life. So that's what I'd want to share as a hospice chaplain.
Thank you, Reverend Patrick. The acceptance of the moment is so hard. It's yes. So hard. And I think that a lot of families do struggle with that. How does one learn to accept the moment and learn to accept what's happening then and there? Do you have any suggestions?
Yes, the moment will continually teach you until you learn the lesson. It'll teach you how to say yes, just listen, and it'll be your most wonderful teacher. It keeps showing up again and again and again. It's amazing. So your teacher's ever with you.
Thank you, Reverend Patrick. Rabbi Ackerman?
Yeah, this one's a really hard one for me. It's hard for me to answer the question of why for those who are suffering, and also hard for me as a chaplain. And I say hard because if I'm too quick to respond to that and provide an answer, then I may be a little quick to impose my faith and theology on them. And I have lots of Jewish patients, but I have patients of diverse religious beliefs, I don't always understand them. I'm not always privy to understand that they can speak to what they believe and hold true and dear. But the other reason why maybe reluctant to rush in with an answer in their aid is because to recognize that to do so is kind of speaks towards my own discomfort in those situations, and maybe to take a little bit of time and recognize the immensity of the crisis that they're in. So my preference is first and is to approach with compassion, to sit beside them, sometimes with them in suffering, to let them know that they're suffering, that it's real and it's reasonable. And it's an expected response to the condition that they're in and where they are in their life and having to say goodbye. And that's not because they're suffering because they're weak or they're lacking or they're mistaken, but they suffer and they have pain because they're human. And then it's okay to cry. We're physical beings and we have physical needs. And whatever our beliefs about the origin of our lives and our understanding of eternity, we rely on and influence our physical world. That is, for most of us, our primary mode of living. But across the diverse systems of religion and spirituality, most of us believe or understand and our existence isn't only physical. The physical limitations of this world we live in have a profound influence on our emotion and spiritual being, and also that our emotional and spiritual selves are connected to and not limited by our spirit, by physical realities, that we always have the possibility of comfort, hope, and salvation. That addressing our hopes, needs, and desires in this world necessitates an awareness of our spirit and its needs as well. If we only focus on the physical, we ignore our spiritual selves, then that's when we will allow ourselves to suffer. I want to share with you just a little message I shared with my hospice group a few weeks ago in an email as we wrapped up the week. I wrote to them, while talking recently with the daughter of a new patient with dementia, I was shaken by her words of longing and sadness. As she said, I feel like I can't reach out far enough to touch my mother. These words, few though they are, they expressed her desire to connect with such strength, her desire to provide comfort and to hold on to her mother. She described with a haunting beauty the pain that many clients in hospice feel when intimate relationships are facing disruption and change. I share this story because we often hold up as acceptance and letting go as ideals. And I think that they're valuable, with lessons that I need to learn. And we do this because our wish for our patients, our clients, is that they arrive at some peace with a new reality. But I guess I also just want to call at this moment to say that that it's also human to yearn and to want and desire and to need. And these are not bad things, that we should also recognize their place as well.
Yeah, and I think that's part of developing that compassion for ourselves, right? To recognize that all these feelings when we are going through very difficult situations are normal. And, you know, sometimes we tend to reject them and try not to feel them because that, you know, it might be shameful, whatever that may be, that makes us feel having them. I think you addressed a very important point, to be compassionate and to just understand that this is normal given the situation and what we are living, what we're going through. So thank you. My next question for all of you is, for some family caregivers, it is very hard to discuss their fears and sadness about death and dying. Many times they might use their faith and religious beliefs to protect themselves from addressing those feelings. For example, if they have a loved one who is dying and the loved one might want to talk about their condition, they might say, you just need to pray or God will take care of it. Don't give up. You will be fine. So what would you tell that family caregiver who is afraid of talking about death and dying with their loved one? Father Puico?
Thank you. Well, following the last intervention, I believe that, next to compassion or to being compassionate is also to learn how to be vulnerable. That being vulnerable is not as bad as society tells us that it is. What I'm saying is that it's not only being vulnerable to myself, I mean, me accepting my reality, but also to others. Because when I realize my limits, then I begin to trust others. So others can make difficult decisions for me too. And if I am the family member, so also I can rely on other people, the extended family. Of course, you know, our individualistic society is teaching us that we can do it all, but it's not always the case. So I believe that that we need to learn that we find in other people that support that is very much needed. Now, one thing that I believe we need to be careful is, you know, the idea of simplifying the moment of you know, of an emergency or death, like saying, oh, you're gonna be fine. I mean, I don't know if you have ever been sick, but when we are sick, we ourselves. I'm not saying somebody else who is my loved one, but when we are sick, we don't want people to make us believe that this is fine. I mean, as I said before, God is in control, but I am not. I mean, I'm so vulnerable that I can't control this situation. So that is why I believe that true love comes into place. You were mentioning, somebody was mentioning about, you know, I can reach far enough that I can touch my mother. I believe that physical touch, that desire to be close to my loved one is so much needed. And to basically, you know, to whisper, to the other person, I love you, I'm here for you. Not so much of, you know, this is all in control, we're okay, and you're gonna be fine. I mean, you know what I mean? It's very important to be also realistic, that this is a difficult situation, that we are with you, that we're together in this, that you are not alone, I'm not going to leave you alone, and that we're suffering this together. To the point that we can even feel the suffering of the other person. So I believe that is important. And of course, you know, that we pray for the other person. I remember last week I went to the hospital and this woman said, I can't pray and I don't want to pray. Because the person was exhausted by the pain. So I told her, well, can I pray for you? And I did. And I said, please don't say anything. And then, you know, that moment of quietness came into place and silence, and you could feel the solitude, right? I mean, the value of being just there, of that emptiness that is filled by God. So, yeah, so I would say, then I also assure, of course, you know, my parishioners of my own prayer. And I, you know, I have the practice of signaling my own heart. I'm trying to make the other person understand that she or he is with me, that we're together in this. And finally, I believe that our being in God's children is much more deeper than any other relationship, right? So when we realize that we are connected through the same Father God, then life is much easier because you are not alone.
Thank you so much. That was very profound. It's true that vulnerability doesn't mean to be weak, but really to be courageous and to open yourself up and to accept the moment and to be realistic about it, which a lot of the times it can be very painful. Right. So Reverend Cabada,
okay, as far as I sense things to be, religion basically was a response to death. The religious consciousness was Homo sapiens' attempt to address the reality of our mortality. And so different religions have been trying to respond to that existential pain. And Buddhism, you know, like a world religion, begins with acknowledging the dis-ease of our existence, dis-ease. And so I see the Buddha historically as a spiritual pathologist. He identified the cause of the dis-ease as separation from loved ones, having to associate with those we have difficulties with, things not going on, and aging, sickness, death. You know, these are universal conditions of the human condition. And then just to come to terms with that is to identify the cause of the disease. And his insight was the ignorance and the attachments, and then the anger, anxiety, resistance that comes out of that. But then he made a prognosis of the cure. And that's the whole process of what we call the Eightfold Noble Path that begins with right view, to see things clearly, to understand the facts, the reality of our existence as, well, the second law of physics is entropy, that everything changes, nothing stays the same. And so with that awareness, we begin to so-called open up our hearts and minds to begin to sense the oneness of our being beyond the finite, limited moral beings that we are. And so I'll just offer the parable of the mustard seed. I've read it in different forms, but I learned it as a Sunday school kid. You know, the parable of the mustard seed, anyone familiar with this one? Yeah, and that's the one where a young mother loses her precious child and is just insane with grief and trying to find out some way to bring the child back to life. And then somebody just suggested to her that she go visit the Buddha. And she approached the Buddha saying, please bring my son back to life. And do you remember how that story goes? In response to her pleas, he suggested, encouraged her to go look for a handful of mustard seeds. And she travels around the village from house to house, asking, first of all, the Buddha said, ask before you receive the mustard seeds, ask if that family had ever experienced the loss of a loved one. And as she moved from house to house, it gradually dawned on her that this is the natural condition of all existence. The moment we were born, we were beginning this process that will not end, but encounter this change we call death. And that opened her heart and mind. And she proceeded to conduct the traditional ritual forms for her child, but then she became a follower of the Buddha, a nun. And she was known as number one in compassion. So this is the way that we could, I think as chaplains, I'm sure you all appreciate the fact that we're there to offer support in compassion and to hear the pain, but to recognize. And this is what I'll close with, is the acronym RAIN, R-A-I-N. Have you ever heard this one? Okay, well, that's my thing, so I can look for acronyms. So RAIN is recognize. Recognize this is a difficult, painful situation. But then accept the fact that this is how we would naturally or normally react. But then investigate, where is this coming from? And then to begin to realize the end, and there are various forms, of end, but the one I'll share today is nurture. So through that process of recognize, accept, investigate, we come to nurture a deeper awareness and appreciation of the fragility of our life. And in that respect, the preciousness of life, because in a spiritual view of, as far as what I appreciate as Buddhism, this being born into human life is not to be taken for granted, because it's received as an opportunity for awakening, to break out of the cycle of delusion and to awaken to the Buddhahood within that we all share in common, the oneness of life. So thank you.
Thank you,
Reverend. For all the work that you do.
Thank you. Thank you. Reverend Patrick?
Yes, as a hospice chaplain working with people every day that have terminal illness, what I find is helpful, what's healing, what's hopeful for people is not either spiritually or religiously giving people simple answers, which I often see clergy doing. But what I think really is healing to people is if you're able to give them permission, and it's a permission to step into the darkness that's in their life. Maybe it's fear, and it's okay to deal with what's scary. It's okay to deal with what's unknown in their life. And I really try to give that permission by being there with them as a compassionate caregiver. So I might say something like, this illness seems like something that's really hard for you to deal with right now, or life seems really scary right now. So I would want to be a spiritual companion with that person and let them know that together we can walk into this time of fear and doubt and darkness. And I may not have all the answers, but I'd want to communicate that together our souls can face the unknown, and together we can face this scary journey of life, and together we can walk into the darkness, and I'll be there with you in the darkness. And I find that's what's really healing in people's lives as a hospice chaplain.
We can hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Reverend Patrick. Rabbi Ackerman?
Yeah, I want to start by saying that I think that speaking with a loved one about death is not easy, at least if we're not accustomed to it. Most of us are not. We're accustomed to good health or good enough health. We don't go through our daily lives thinking about our own demise or the death of those we love. We're, as caregivers, involved in caring for a friend or family member and try with all of our ability to ease their pain. And the thought of discussing death comes with concern for causing emotional and spiritual harm for the person we're taking care of. Many people have expressed this feeling that are concerned that if they bring up death, then they'll add to the person's suffering and kind of upset any hope or peace that the person has. I believe if the loved one has the cognitive capacity to discuss death, it's likely on their mind, whether we talk about it or not. And leaving it as an unwelcome topic is likely to foster increased anxiety for them, for us, to introduce distance between the person we're caring for and ourselves. And when we pay attention to their need to discuss, we show respect that they still have a spiritual capacity for hope and to take care of themselves. Not ubiquitous. It's not uncommon to find individuals who are approaching the end of their life, and they have a very keen awareness of their remaining time. They'll know they're just, they might say, in a few days, that's all I have. And this could feel like a hammer that's waiting to fall, or for some, it might be provide a sense of relief after prolonged distress. When we're able to be there for people who are dying, we can help them make this time a little less scary. The other side of this, though, maybe a bigger side, is the difficulty of a caregiver, right, being there, willing to discuss. It's the pain of acknowledging our own loss, our own distress, our own grief, the prospect of losing this person. And it's hard to let go. But we can, if we can identify that grief, we can name it, we might be able to do something with it. And at that point, we can be there for the one we care for with their most pressing needs.
Thank you. So true. It's true. We don't go about life thinking, oh, I might die tomorrow, or my loved one might die tomorrow. And it's hard. It's hard to talk about it if we are not ready, if we haven't practiced that conversation throughout our lives. So I have a couple more questions, but I also want to leave space for the audience to submit your questions. So if you have any questions for our panelists, please feel free to use our Q&A box. We do have one question that was submitted. So I'm going to go ahead and read that to all of you, and if all of you could address it. It says, would you, all of you, speak to how you go into this work as wounded healers? What of yourself do you bring to this work? Father Quickbo?
I believe that everybody's pausing here. I mean, I myself can say that I can say that I bring myself. I will be lying. I try to bring, as I tell my parishioners here, I try to bring the God, I mean, the God that I believe in, to believe in God that I believe I have inside of me. So that presence is the one that I bring, not that I am God, of course, but you know what I mean, is a divine presence that can flow through me as I am his earthen bosom. And I have been mentioning surrender and compassion and vulnerability. I don't believe this may sound simple, but I believe that the ministry of presence is much more important at times than the many words that we can give. This world is so filled with words, and we want to have an answer to everything. But sometimes at the end of life, we don't have an answer. Actually, we don't, because nobody has been in eternity and come back, other than what we believe in faith. So that is what I bring, my faith and my God.
Thank you
so much. At the end is our faith and our God, you know what I mean.
Thank you, Father Quickbo. Reverend Kubata?
Well, I could acknowledge being wounded, but I don't know about the healer part. I just participate in the situations I find myself in. And I see the idea of healing as bringing wholeness, because etymologically the word heal comes from whole, and it's related to health. So I see our spiritual life as being one of becoming whole, healed, healthy. And you know, that's what I like to feel that I've appreciated from my engagement with this religion resource we call Buddhism, to give that sense of wholeness to my being, but acknowledging, recognizing I'm a fallible, what do you call, finite, mortal being, but that's the outward, the external form that I've received. But through this momentary experience in human life, I've encountered what we call the teachings, the Dharma, the reality, the truth of what the Buddha woke up to as a guide to help, you know, bring that sense of healing, wholeness. And that's what I feel like I used to try to, you know, I continue to try to appreciate and share with whoever is receptive to that resource. Yeah, so to awaken to the Buddha within, that's the resource that I see as the way we sense spiritual healing.
Thank you, Reverend Kubata. Reverend Patrick?
Many years ago, I had the experience of hiking the Appalachian Trail solo from Georgia to Maine, the 2,000 miles, to help open a shelter for homeless people. And part of that experience was getting sick and my pack getting struck by lightning. And I had a near-death experience. And it just really oriented me to just the immense beauty of divine light, divine joy, divine hope that seems right at the core of all of our lives in the universe and the present moment. And so as a hospice chaplain, I just share with people in any way that I can that presence of divine light and divine joy that's so much a part of our lives, and help people step into it and experience it. And if you get a taste of it, your life is never the same. So it's wonderful to really have the opportunity to to be with people in sometimes impossible situations and see divine joy showing up, you know, divine hope, divine peace, and just how it's happening in this moment. It's amazing. So it's a wonderful place to be with people.
So. Thank you, Reverend Patrick. Rabbi Ackerman?
Yeah, I want to start by acknowledging just on a personal level, I remember hearing about the death of a college roommate of mine. And after having experienced a number of deaths of friends in the preceding years, just feeling exhausted and not being able to deal with it. And for myself and not being there for other people. And I don't share that story to express feelings of shame or regret, but to kind of maybe normalize just how hard it can be. We're called to be there for other people and to serve. And sometimes we may lack that ability, that energy. And there may be times when we have to show ourselves kindness before we can be there for other people. So I think the wounded healer sometimes has to take care of their wounds as well. The gospel, the scripture that I want to share is not from my own tradition. It comes from John in chapter 19. I had to look it up. I don't know chapter and verse, but this is when Jesus is on the cross and Jesus is there crucified. And John relates that near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple who he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, the disciple took her into his home. And this powerful image of Mary and the others being by the side of the cross, being there, and to experiencing, right, the agony of Christ on the cross, right, that Christ is experiencing, but also them and their love for Jesus, and that they saw themselves in their ability to minister to Jesus, to be there for Christ, right, and I think it should be a lesson for us that it doesn't take the greatest person. You don't have to have everything, right? And sometimes even people who you look towards with of tremendous spiritual strength, and you wonder, what can I offer that person? Well, here's a story for you.
Thank you. We have more questions from the audience. Our next question says, if the caregiver is religious, but the hospice patient is not, should the caregiver speak about spirituality or remain silent? Father Quickbo?
I believe we can always talk about, I want to say spirituality. That's not the moment to litigate or to impose religious views. It would be completely imprudent, but I believe that we all have a God, and we can talk about the beauty of life in God at that moment. I haven't ever found anybody in my ministry that I tell I'm going to pray for you and says no or rejects my offer. So I believe that other people here have much more experience than I do in hospice care. But when I go to hospitals, I go to any room always offering prayer, and I have never, ever found any kind of rejection. So I would say yes.
Thank you, Father Pupo. Reverend Kubata?
Well, I don't know about religion. My view, I guess, is that, you know, spirituality is our sense of being. And so whether the religious form can connect with that or relate to it or even offer any kind of insights Well, that's up to each individual. So I'm not there to offer a religious perspective, but actually to share the appreciation of our spiritual essence of our being, and to bring that sense of being and keep it alive. And then having that clearer view, in my view anyway. You know, I just noticed that we're all wearing glasses, all the panelists, and we all have glasses in the form, but I'm sure the prescriptions are different. But the basic aspiration is to see clearly. And that, I think, is what the spiritual engagement entails, is to see, you know, things clearly. And then from that, the appreciation of this finite existence is the opening to the infinite life that we're a part of.
Thank you, Reverend Kubata. Reverend Patrick?
As a hospice chaplain, when I'm visiting patients and families, I always begin with the spirituality of what's happening in the present moment. What's going on in this moment? Is it a moment of fear, a moment of joy, a moment of hope, a moment of despair? And that's always the beginning of our journey together, is whatever it is that's unfolding. And if religion is being brought into it, for me, I always do it by invitation. So is this something you would like to talk about? Would you like a prayer? Would you like a blessing? And so I kind of open the door and then see where people want to go with it. But I think if you sort of step into the present moment of what you're experiencing in your heart and soul, that's just so healing to people, and give them permission to explore this present moment however they want to go with it. So.
Thank you. Robbie Ackerman?
Yeah, I'm glad that I get to follow after after all of you, and takes a little time on my thoughts. I would say that, kind of repeat that it's important to be there in the room, to remember that you're in front of a person of immense worth, innate worth, and let that person be your guide, be your teacher, that when we bring an agenda, maybe some of my language and my first response led to this, but we may seek to control a situation and to place our own beliefs on that person. And I think that's something that they can only do for themselves, right? If someone's going to find hope, they need to do it for themselves. They need to find the locus of that, right? And we can be of assistance, we can help, but there, I want people to recognize the spiritual strengths that are within them and the life that they've lived as a source of strength. And if their religion is one of those places, then that's good that we can talk about that. But it's really important in my work to convey that spirituality is something that is broader than that. And if someone tells me they're not religious, it usually demands a pretty quick response of saying that, we all have ways of coming to a sense of what happens to us and what our purpose is and what we can do. And all those things are happening to you and you're doing them. And I wanted to hear what you think about that.
Thank you. So we are almost at the end of the hour, but we have so many questions from the audience. So I would like to address at least a couple more if you all have a few more minutes to stay. My next question is actually for Father Puigbo, and it comes from the audience. It says, my 94-year-old mother just lost her husband, my father, of over 70 years. She's questioning where he is and whether they will be reunited when she dies. With all of who have gone before, and not just him, but with everyone who has gone before, she says, we are Catholic. and her sister is the main caregiver.
Well, that is what we see in the gospel, right? That Jesus says that we're going to be with him in heaven. And the book of Revelation says that that is the eternal banquet. It's going to be a feast, the wedding feast. And that we are going to be all contemplating God the Father and enjoying eternity with him. So yes, we are going to be reunited in heaven, of course. We are not going to be having the same opinions that we have now, which is, I mean, this is our body, and our body stays here, and our souls go up to God's presence.
Thank you. So our next question comes from the audience, and it's for all of you. It says, my 89-year-old mom wants to talk about her funeral plans whenever I visit her. Having gone through this with my day, it is very hard to go through this again. Do you think, I think it meant having gone through this with my dad, it is very hard to go through this again. Do you think it would be okay to ask her to record this information and message so that the entire family can hear her wishes in her own words? If we can start with Father Puigbo and then we'll move on.
Well, I believe there are people more expert in this. I guess, I see that Reverend Patrick is very into hospice, and so he may have more knowledge.
Reverend Patrick or Rabbi Ackerman, do you want to take on that question?
I would tell her, sure, it's fine to record it. I might want to delve a little bit into what the person's finding difficult to listen to. If I kind of just sense a feeling of denial, that it sounds like it's kind of hard for this person to accept that their mother's dying and coming to peace with that. So I might want to explore that. If that person's in hospice care or has a pastor, that might be something that could be part of that journey, that maybe that could be shared with a pastor. And maybe we could work on this together. I do that a lot with patients. They do share their funeral planning with me a lot. And then I share it with family. So this could be a real role for a hospice chaplain to work with the patient and the family. Sure.
Thank you, Reverend Patrick.
I just want to follow on in just a little bit. I think that I always refrain from trying to pass any type of evaluation or judgment. I think if that is what works best in for this family, for this the mother, then that sounds to me like a reasonable approach. My concern that remains is why they want to talk about this. Reverend Patrick, you spoke about maybe discomfort or difficulty accepting, but I think there is a need was the mother, I think the one who's ill, to be reassured that she'll be taken care of. And if the video can provide that for her, then that sounds good. But I think that's something that's worth assessing, holding on to that question.
Thank you. Thank you. And I don't want to go beyond your time. So I have one last question for all of you. How does your faith view death and what happens after death? We kind of have touched on that, but if you want to go on a little bit more, and let's start with Father Puigbo.
Well, heaven. Yeah. That's our ultimate goal. Somebody told me today, because we were expecting a tornado, and she said, well, are you afraid? No, I mean, I have no fear in going to my father's house at all. So you don't want to tell my mother that, because she's going to say, you're going to stay here longer. But yes, our Christianity sees death as an opportunity to go to God and be with him.
Thank you. Reverend
Kobata? I used to kind of sarcastically respond to that question by saying, we have funeral rituals. That's what happens after you die. There are these funeral rituals that have developed in cultures. Yeah. But doctrinally, you know, meaning what's written that we're supposed to understand is that entrusting in the Buddha, Amida, the spiritual cosmic Buddha, we are reborn in the Pure Land to become Buddhas. And then we return to this world of suffering to guide others. So that's the doctrinal view. Other than that, I can't speak to what happens because I don't know yet. So that's the situation. But, you know, that idea of being reborn as Buddhas, I think is, in our culture anyway, a very encouraging and kind of comforting awareness. Yeah, but the whole question about, you know, what happens after we die, I think should be reversed to look at what's happening with this life here and now.
Thank you. Thank you. Reverend Patrick?
Before I had a near-death experience, I used to feel there was kind of a concrete wall between this life and the next. But after that, I felt that what separates this life and the next is tissue paper, if it's anything at all. And I see more and more this kind of eternal divine presence as the source of everything that is, everything that has been, everything that will be. And it just seems like there's really nothing to fear. It just feels like the next life is so amazing and so wonderful that it's really can't wait to be there. So it's really an amazing place to go. You can't put it into words, but it just kind of erased that fear of the end of this physical life for me. So.
Thank you, Reverend Patrick. Ravi Ackerman?
Yeah, I'll start by saying that Judaism is not really doctrinal in this, and it's hard to really come to kind of an appreciation of core beliefs. There you might find some common beliefs. A lot of the mysteries of death and after death remain for me and a lot of people of religious Jewish practice. Death is typically understood as it's something sad. I'm glad to hear from Reverend Kubota, and it's just such a powerful teaching that in that kind of the ability that to see, to have something beyond this world. But Jewish death is universally accompanied by mourning, and that mourning is deemed appropriate. I would say that where myself and Reverend Kubota really maybe kind of see eye to eye is that distinction or that the significance of our lives in this world. The rabbis and also the Bible, the Hebrew Bible, don't spend a lot of effort and time discussing the world to come. And its interest is what do we do in this world.
Thank you. Thank you. So focus on this life because that's the only one you have. Thank you. Thank you so much. We are at the end of the hour, and I hope that every one of you in the audience found this conversation helpful and that we were able to address key aspects that are going to help you in your personal journey, and especially when caring for someone that you love. I also want to thank everyone who attended today, especially our panelists. Thank you so much for your time, for your knowledge and your wisdom, and for sharing that with all of us. I'm very grateful. And to everyone in the audience, thank you so much for staying the hour with us. I want to ask you if you could take a moment to answer our survey. It really helped us provide topics that you are interested in. And I hope you all have a wonderful afternoon, everyone. Thank you.